Okay, hemial concentration, in the interest of time, because I'm dedicated to get this done under time, is outlined there. You can read it on your own. Immediate inversion. Okay, how to stop candida albicans and blood clotting from happening is through immediate inversion. That means as soon as it comes out of the person's arm, you have to invert the tube. A phlebotomist, you're never going to be able to crush in court. The only thing you're going to do is look like you're a meanie to them. So I always ask them open-ended questions. What did you do with the blood after you got it out? And they'll say, well, I put it over in the tray. Okay, are you sure? Yes. Are you double sure? Yes. That's the way you always do it. Yes. Get them committed to that. There's no inversion that's there. Leave it alone. That's fine. Or number two is, well, I took it and I inverted the tube, and what they'll do is they'll show you shaking it up and down. That can cause hemolysis, but more importantly, it's the wrong way of doing it. So this is the way that it's supposed to be done, as opposed to what they actually do. They take it out of the arm, they take the needle out, and they either do nothing or they shake it up and down. That's not the right way of doing it. That's not mixing it. That's not the proper way of mixing it. Instead, what they should do is, after they take it out of the arm and they remove the needle, is they gently invert it. And I want you to take a look at how long this takes to do. It takes a long time to do it properly, because what happens is you're trying to get those salts that are at the bottom to evenly distribute throughout the blood. And that's only done by doing it slowly, so the bubble that's there transverses the entire thing and makes it evenly distributed. So it takes forever. Don't be afraid of the phlebotomist and the open-ended question that's there, because even if they know that they're supposed to invert the tube, or the DA has grabbed their ear beforehand and said, make sure you remember that you inverted the tube, have them show it in front of a jury, they will likely only do it 3 times or less, not the magic 8 times. It's 8 times is the key. That's what the manufacturer says. It takes forever. It's still going on right now. And the reason why is because of clotting. If you don't have the correct activation that's of the tubes that are there, not only is candida albicans a problem, but so is clotting. You will get state scientists or supposed scientists that come in and say, I can always spot clots. It's no problem. It's no issue. I can always see it. BS. You can. That is a clot right there. If it's inside the tube, that's right, you're not going to be able to spot it. It can cause great problems, because what it does is it converts what is supposed to be a whole blood sample into a serum sample. Remember, serum sample, it's overreported, like we talked about earlier. So you need to have inversion. Short draw versus long draw, that has to do with salting out, that we're going to get to here in a minute. And one of the important themes that you have there is there's no way that a phlebotomist or a technologist or anything like that is ever, ever, ever going to remember your guy or this tube as opposed to anything else. So it lends itself to a great amount of cross-examination, which is, you know, you don't remember my guy, you don't know anything about my guy, you don't remember anything about this tube, you know, anything like that. So the only thing you're going to tell me at the end of the day is this is the way you always do it, and you never ever make a mistake, right? I mean, that's basically what they're going to try and sell to the jury. Their habit, their custom, their perfection. That's one way. But another way to take a look at it is in your closing, to sit there and illustrate very simply that in criminal law, there isn't the presumption that the analyst did it right. It's not the presumption that the tube was inverted. There is no presumption that there wasn't candida albicans. There's only one presumption in a criminal case, and only one, the presumption of innocence. So you cannot presume that these people inside the lab did the right thing. You can say they meant to do the right thing, but you have to prove it, because it's called proof at the end of the day. Okay, specimen collection, we talked about some of those things, skipping right along to get to the key one that's here. Difference between a technologist who's a machine operator and an expert. Don't let a machine operator come in there and try and tell you about salting out or any of these other things that we went through at the end of the day. Pipetting, you know, because all these things are dependent upon how much volume you get. It's like baking a cake. If you don't do it the right way, then you're going to get something wrong. And those are analytical things. Hemolysis we touched on already. You can read about that. Hematocrit you can also read about. And what I really want to do here is, this is my second to last concept that I want to talk to you good folks about, is the problem of salting out. If you remember in this particular slide how we came and we arrived at getting a gas chromatography type of result, and how it elutes out the chemicals that go out there. And that's based upon that headspace, the partitioning that occurs. And that's how we get there. All right, if there is too low of a draw, meaning that instead of 10 milliliters, you're getting 6, you're getting 5, you're getting 4, it lends itself to what's called the salting out defense. As we had talked about before, it is that heating, that incubation that has the analytes of interest that we're looking for go up into the gaseous phase or the top phase that's there. So on the left-hand side is what we would expect to see if everything was normal and everything was right. In a short draw situation, what ends up happening is the salts exist in that same tight space. It's like being in a very, very enclosed closet, okay? Where what ends up happening is that there's too much ethanol being pushed out of the liquid phase, and it creates a salting out effect. And the salting out effect means that there's too much there, it goes through the column, and it reports too much. Okay, not important for you to understand the process, but to understand that the low blood sample amount, instead of 10 milliliters, if it's 6, 5, or 4, that's no good. All right, chain of custody, I think most people know chain of custody and how important it is. But one of the things that I think is very important is to take a look. Let's do this. At the magic number and how we arrive at the magic number and what that means. What I was hoping to show you good folks here is something like this. Okay, that's kind of what they're doing, right? They're pulling a magic number out of the hat. You have to understand the process and how it goes and reporting of uncertainty. I wish I had more time, which I clearly don't. But the big thing to know is that at the end of the process, you can't let them come into court and say that it's a 162, and it's definitely a 162, without saying it's a plus or minus amount, and that over a period of time that there's enough variance that's there, because the measurement is a single representation in time that's there, and it has to do with accuracy and precision. But what we constantly deal with and what we constantly fight against, of course, is the conflict between the war on DUI and the war on truth and the dueling axes that go along with that, and sometimes you feel like you're the person in the middle. The most important thing that I hope that you take away from this lecture is that there's this whole world of analytical chemistry that's out there. Don't accept the number as being reported as a 0.162 as an absolute, any more than you would a police report that comes out at the end of the day that says, your guy is guilty of DUI. You need more information. You need to pull back the onion. You need to take a look at it. I have 2 minutes of slide. I know I'm a little bit over my time, so if you would indulge me, I'd like to thank you for your attention that's here. My name is Justin McShane, and I'm so happy to be here with you good folks. Let the drama kick, let the drama kick die. Let the drama kick, let the drama kick die. Let the drama kick, let the drama kick die.